And this week, I want to talk about what message are we proclaiming? What message are we proclaiming? As usual, I'm in the book of Acts this week. We've been studying and looking at the book of Acts in different aspects. And today, I just felt like asking the question, what message are we proclaiming? It's an important question, because I think what is unknown to the world is that we all proclaim a message. We are all proclaiming a message. We're all advocating for something. You're advocating for something. And then my question to you is, what is it? What are you proclaiming? What's your message? We've shifted in the book of Acts. At first, we were focusing on the early church. We were focusing on Peter, Saul's conversion. He becomes Paul. Well, the rest of the book, we're really going to be focusing on Paul's missionary journey. So he has three missionary journeys. There is the Jerusalem Council, which we will talk about. And then he has a second and a third missionary journey. And then he ends up being imprisoned. So we're really just going to look throughout that through the month of November, be looking at the early church, and hopefully gain wisdom from the early church. Now, as you know, there was a church in Jerusalem, and it had spread to Antioch, which was north of Jerusalem, and north as in heading towards Rome, right? Rome was the big city at this time. There was the Roman Empire, which occupied Israel, and Rome was the center of the Roman Empire. And so the gospel is spreading towards that, and it makes its way to Antioch. And so let's just read about the Antioch church. There were some people there, and so Acts 13, 1 through 3 says this, "Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manon, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.' So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off." And so here we read about the first sent people, right? And they're not actually the first sent people. If you remember in the Gospel of John, Jesus is talking to his disciples and he says, "As the Father has sent me," right? Jesus is the first one sent from the Father. He is a missionary to the world. He says, "I am sending you." But now we get to see the book of Acts referenced this sent people, and I just want to talk about that for a moment. Missionary means, literally means, a person who is sent. That's the origins from it. Missio is the root word, and it's a Greek word, missio, which means sent. It's where we get the word missile, right? When you think of a missile that is sent from one country to another, it is a sending. The early church clearly took this as an important thing. They're sending out Paul and Barnabas to go be missionaries in a place where they're not just staying put, but they're going from place to place and interacting. And so the early church centered their focus on missions, or being sent towards God, by two ways. By two ways. Fasting and praying, and empowering others by laying on hands. So I just want to say this, and I might have said this quote before. I plan on saying it a lot because I think it's really important, and I'll just repeat it here. It's not that God's church has a mission. It's that God's mission has a church. Let me repeat that again. It's not that God's church has a mission, right? The church, the big C, I'm talking about the big C. It's not that God's church has a mission. It's that God's mission has a church. That God it has sent people to go out, and the church is supposed to help provide the stability for those missionaries. And that we are all sent, and we should all be pointing towards God's mission, and not everybody is sent away to here or to there, but we are all sent to our communities to bring the word of God. And you might say, wow, Pastor Sheen focuses so much on missionary people. That's all he talks about. Well, I think it's important for us to refocus on the main things, right? And I think one of the main things is our missionary vocation. As people of God, we are saved not just to be in a community together and be sectarian and just sit here until we go to heaven. It's not an otherworldly faith. Christianity is not an otherworldly faith. It's a here faith. It's a right now faith. We are called out to be sent back out. We are called out to be sent back out. And so the early church centered their focus on missions towards God by fasting and praying. How much do we fast and pray? Judging by the weight of most Americans, I would say probably only a little, right? We don't fast all the time. We don't like to fast. I think you can judge by me. I hate fasting. And then you have those health nuts that are like, ooh, I can't fast. I gotta get the exact calories that I need to work out, and I can't fast because that would sidetrack from my day. But fasting is really, really important. I've talked before that you can fast other things besides food. That is a good thing. Some people have health issues. But fasting food is really important because it's something that we all need. It's not something that we all want. We actually need food. We cannot survive without food. And it's a refocus. And so what the early church did was they fast and prayed so that they refocused their minds. Why did they do that? Well, they realized that they were human, and one thing that comes with being a human is having bad judgments, right? It's not being clear or focused on what we are thinking, and we need God to refocus that, which is why they fasted and prayed. I want to talk about something in specific, and that is that fasting helps you get specific with your prayers. Fasting helps you get specific with your prayers. And what do I mean by that? Sometimes we just pray general prayers. Lord, please help the starving kids in Africa. Lord, please help all the unsaved people. And I'm not saying that those prayers are bad, but it's missing a piece or the component of what God is calling us to do. As missionary people who are sent out by God, we should be thinking of specific people who we're praying for. Maybe you have a group of people that maybe you're part of a school and you just pray for the whole school. And I think that that's good. But there are specific people in your life that you need to be praying for alone. When I think of all the people on our list and I'm praying, I don't look at the list and say, Lord, just cover all these prayers. But I pray for one, each and every one, specifically. And what that allows you to do is interact with that person and let God give you a chance to stir your heart. It creates focus. And so as you're praying and fasting, be specific in your prayers. Not just general, but specific. But they also empowered others by laying on of hands. It's this practice of commissioning the believers to go and have their own ministry. I think this is lacking in the church, right? I think it's so important that we, as leaders of the church, are praying over the next generation, the next people, and saying, go and be missionaries. It's empowering people to pursue the mission that God has called them to do. And what this does is it takes it out of our hands a little bit. I know that some of us, we get a little bit frustrated with like mega churches, right? There's these huge mega churches, and we're just like, oh, we don't like them, but we don't really know why we don't like them. Well, one critique that I have of a mega church is they're not sending churches. They're not river churches, but lake churches. They want to grow and grow and grow. But, and what that does is it allows for control. I can control this. I can control that. Well, part of God's mission is letting go and saying, I am sending people out and I no longer have control, but I'm trusting God does. And so we see them send out Paul and Barnabas, and as they're traveling, they encounter Jews and God-fearing Gentiles. See, Paul and Barnabas were looking for synagogues. The Jewish nation had dispersed and been in exile, and they formed different places where there was Jewish hubs. And these Jewish hubs would meet in synagogues, and they would meet together, and maybe they lived in Antioch or in Cyprus or Iconium, and they would have these synagogues where they could meet back together. And Paul and Barnabas were going to these synagogues and sharing the message of Jesus with people who they knew might respond to their message. People who they knew what their background was, right? And so they were sharing about the Jewish scriptures and the Jewish Messiah, and what they were saying was, Jesus is the Jewish Messiah. But then they come to a town, this is during their first missionary journey, of Lystra, and they encounter a different situation. So I'm going to pick up in Acts 14, verses 8 through 20. And this is where we're going to try to focus a little bit for today and really read about something different. Something where they're interacting with people who have no Jewish background or understand little about the Jewish church. So Acts 14, starting in verse 8. In Lystra, there sat a man who was lame. He had been that way from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul as he was speaking. Paul looked directly at him, saw that he had faith to be healed, and called out, "Stand up on your feet." At that, the man jumped up and began to walk. When the crowd saw this, saw what Paul had done, they shouted in the Lyconian language, "The gods have come down to us in human form." Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul they called Hermes because he was the chief speaker. The priest of Zeus, whose temple was just outside the city, brought bowls and wreaths to the city gate because he and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifices to them. But when the apostles and Paul heard this, they tore their clothes and rushed out into the crowd. "Friends, why are you doing this? We are only humans, like you. God, who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them, in the past, he let all nations go their own way. Yet he has not left himself without a testimony. He has shown kindness by giving you rain from the heavens and crops in the season. He provides you with plenty of food and fills your hearts with joy." Even with these words, they had difficulties keeping the crowd from sacrificing to them. Then some Jews from Antioch and Iconium came and won the crowd over. They stoned Paul and dragged him outside of the city, thinking he was dead. But after the disciples had gathered around him, he got up and went back into the city. The next day, he and Barnabas left for Derbe. So this is an interesting story. And at first, you know, we see this healing. Paul is teaching, and somebody is miraculously healed. And then Paul and Barnabas are mistaken for gods, right? Greek gods, Zeus and Hermes. They give a testimony towards God. And then other Jews come and stone Paul and drag him outside of the city. But this is an important story because it's a shift, right? And I will always say, where there is a shift in missions, it is important to pay attention to what God is doing. Right? When God moves from one group of people to another group of people, particularly he was just preaching, Paul and Peter were just preaching to Jews, now they are preaching to Gentiles who do not understand the Jewish faith. It's important to pay attention to that shift. We can learn a lot about culture if we are paying attention to how God reaches new people, how they communicated their language. And notice something. Paul and Barnabas aren't quoting scripture. Paul and Barnabas are not quoting scripture to people who didn't know scripture. I think that that's important. Now listen, I love scripture. I love paying attention to God and growing in it. But sometimes we quote scripture to people who have no clue what we're talking about, who don't understand it. We see a shift similar to this in our culture, right? So there's a shift from people who knew the Old Testament, and now they're talking to people who do not know the Old Testament. In our culture, Christianity is losing its influence. And Bible knowledge is decreasing by a lot. We were at the center of culture, right? In American culture, Christianity was right at the center. Especially after the Second Great Awakening, the First Great Awakening, the Second Great Awakening in America, it is going from the center to now it is going to the margins. And one thing I notice about Christians is that when this is happening, we end up complaining. The world is so bad out there. We just get so frustrated and we point out the bad, right? Oh man, this culture is so bad. We got to point out this part and this part. And there's a place for that, right? There's a place to point out the problems with our culture. But I don't think that Christianity has a problem. I think Christianity has an opportunity. The less people know about the Bible, the better the opportunity for God's missionary work to happen. And why is that? Well, when people know the Bible, they actually try to domesticate the Bible. And what do I mean by that? They try to bring it down and reduce it to something that it is not. We all try to domesticate the Bible. But when people don't know about the Bible, we get this great opportunity to share the good news of Jesus with them. And they don't already understand a whole bunch of things about Christianity, but they only understand a little. And let me say this, that nobody's coming to Jesus by you pointing out all the bad things that they are doing. Now, pointing to a need is really important here. That this is what actually Paul does. He doesn't point out their lack of knowledge, they're not understanding. Rather, he points to their need. He does use pretty critical language. I'm not speaking against critical language, but he calls out the things that they are worshiping as worthless, not their knowledge. The things that they are worshiping is worthless. I can say that most of our culture is worshiping worthless things. And I will say that calling out people's idols is just as dangerous, if not more dangerous, than calling out people's sins. Calling out their idols, the things that they are worshiping. I have a friend who worships media and self-image and their cultural image. And what they find is that they never measure up the cultural image that they should have, to the media of what the media says, right? We see this a bit in COVID, right? It's always the next thing will get you there. And then it gets kicked down the road a little bit. We never measure up. We never meet. If you worship money, it's, if I get enough money, I will be okay. If you worship health, it's, if I do all the right things, I will live a long life. And we find ourselves disheartened by what we're chasing after, where these things lead. But Paul says, hey, listen, all this stuff is worthless. Let me tell you about the one behind, the provider of everything. There's this guy named James K. A. Smith, and he says that man is homo liturgical. Right? Homo liturgical. That means that we were made to worship. Right? That fits in with our biblical worldview. Right? If man is made to worship, we are made to worship God. But when we don't worship God, we start worshiping all these other things. We worship what we love. So whatever you love, you will end up worshiping unless you can worship God. And then as you begin to love things, you can just love them and not worship them. So Paul critiques their creation worship. And he says this, he has shown you kindness by giving you rain from heaven and crops in season. He provides you with plenty of food and filled your hearts with joy. This is a vague criticism right here. Because Paul knew that there were gods behind all of these things. There was a god for joy. There was a god for rain. There was a god for crops. In the Greek culture, there was gods for everything. And Paul is saying, actually, the living God provided all of that. You're worshiping after things rather than worshiping after the main thing. The main one who provides everything. I will always say that we actually don't worship money, or we don't worship media, or we don't worship our job. We usually don't worship things, but what those things provide. What those things provide. So instead of worshiping money, what we really are worshiping is security or self-image. If we're worshiping media, we're worshiping an image that the media is betraying. We don't actually worship things, we worship something behind that thing. And in Christianity, we don't worship the different parts of Christianity. We worship the living God behind all of those things. You know, we worship church, we worship the living God. And Paul saw that they were worshiping gods, but really they weren't worshiping gods. They were worshiping what those gods provided them. And he's saying, listen, let me tell you about a God that actually provides you those things. Paul and Barnabas' reaction to being worshipped is an important one here, right? What do? They tear their clothes. They're freaking out. They're saying, no, do not worship us. In 2 Corinthians 4, 5 through 6, it says this, for what we preached is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Christ's sake. For God, who said, let light shine out of darkness, made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. So Paul and Barnabas are thought to be these gods, Zeus and Hermes. And I think this is important because it tells us actually a little bit about Paul. So Hermes always spoke. He was always the one speaking for Zeus. And Zeus usually didn't speak. And so what we get in that is that Paul was the chief speaker, as Luke says, and that he was doing most of the talking. Now, there was a myth at this point that these gods had visited Lystra, and that nobody worshiped them except this old couple who brought them in. And so they were eager to worship them again. But Paul and Barnabas, they rip off their clothes. And when you rip off your clothes at that point, you're saying, this is blasphemy. And I am repenting of that blasphemy. It's noticing that. And so what they were doing was giving glory to God versus giving glory to themselves. And that 2 Corinthians passage points that out well. And again, it's what message are we proclaiming? Who gets credit for the transformation that we see in our lives? Who gets credit? Recently, I had a friend who was asking me questions about my drug addiction. And, you know, I've been honest with, in high school, I struggled with drugs. And I actually have four friends who have overdosed from heroin, who have passed away because of overdosing from heroin. And honestly, we have such an addictive society these days. We have an overstimulated society. If you want to feel a certain way, you can get access to that. If you want it, you can have it. And a friend of mine asked me, how did you get over your addiction? They just asked me that question. And my answer immediately was, only by Jesus. I couldn't do it on my own, and honestly, I was hopeless without Jesus. I would still be doing drugs today if it was not for Jesus. I can almost guarantee you that. And it really wasn't me speaking, but God speaking through me. Because here's the truth, I give myself way too much credit for the transformation that I've gone through in my life. I say, I've done this, and I've done this, and I've done this. But really, it is important for us to proclaim God's message, not our message, and give Him the glory. So what's your story? What transformation have you been through lately? Have you told somebody that? This transformation that you've been through? And is God the only answer? Or is there other answers to it? Because it's not proclaiming God's message if there is a different answer. It's probably your message. So I'm going to draw us back. I believe that Paul was preaching the gospel to these people who had never heard the gospel before. And I want to draw us back to effectively communicating the gospel. And it's pretty simple. I'm going to give us kind of three steps into effectively communicating the gospel. We must understand three things when effectively communicating the gospel. The first one is gospel essentials, right? What are the essential things in the gospel? Well, I'll share mine. And I talk about the gospel a lot, but I think the Bible permeates with share the gospel. It is so important for us to share the gospel. So this is my gospel essentials. That there was no way to God. We were created in the image of God. We fell. We sinned. There was no way back to God on our own. But God incarnates himself and pursues humans by being made in human likeness, dies on a cross, so that we are made right with God, rises again, and all believers can join in this. He ascends into heaven, and he is ruling over the earth and interceding for us, and his kingdom will have no end. We will come back again and establish his kingdom. And my question is, do we add more to this, right? Do we add more things to the gospel than is necessary? Because this is basic, bare bones. You can share this to anybody. But do we add more? Are we careful in not adding things that are unimportant? And I'll give you, for instance, you're standing in a Methodist church, and some Methodists will say, okay, to receive the gospel, you have to agree with Arminian theology, which believes in free will. Or a Calvinist will say, hey, to believe in the gospel, you have to believe that God predestined everything. Or maybe we interject, well, baptism, right? Or, oh, we're adding more to it. Gospel essentials are so important, and it's important that we don't add unimportant things. To effectively communicate the gospel, we need to know gospel essentials, but we also need to know cultural context. Paul says, God has not left himself without a witness. Every person has a context. You have a context, I have a context. And to understand how to communicate the gospel to somebody, you have to understand their story. We no longer live in a world where you can stand on a street corner and evangelize. You have to know somebody's personal story. You need to listen to their story and look for their story and connect their story to God's story. The times that I've been transformed, the times that I have stepped closer to Jesus, were times that Jesus spoke directly to my situation. Each and every time he speaks to my situation, I am transformed, but when I'm just listening to general things, I'm not as transformed. So understanding others is an important aspect. And then the third aspect that we must understand is the God we serve. God is on the move. Do you see it? I'm just going to read Ephesians 3, 20 through 21. I don't have it up on the screen, and instead I just want you to listen to this passage. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask, according to his power, that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. So you might ask, oh, why do you keep on focusing on the sharing the message? Because it's important for all of us to do. If we want to see God working in our midst, we have to be communicating the gospel to other people, to be sharing in this hope. And I want to hear about it. You know, we talk about people coming to church, how many people are coming to church, or maybe we're interested in what the tithe is, right? These numbers that identify whether we're doing well or not doing well. Well, I think those numbers are important, but they're not everything. And what I will tell you is more important is stories of transformation. Stories of sharing the gospel. I want to hear these stories. I want to know these stories. And last week I gave you a homework assignment, right? That was encourage three people. Think of three people and encourage them. And I'm going to give you homework today. It should be up on the screen. And so each and every one of you should have a bulletin. I would suggest you write this in your bulletin. This is your homework. As I'm saying this, Liv, would you go get the nursery and junior church people? The homework is to share the gospel in some capacity, to make a connection with your story and God's story, and tell it to somebody, or make a connection with their story and God's story. This is what sharing the gospel is making a connection. Finding where God is at work in somebody else's life, or sharing how God is at work in your life. That God is doing something, and I want to join in on that, right? I want to be a part of that. it's important for us to be sharing. So if you guys would stand, we're going to pray, but kids are going to be walking in, so it's going to be a little sidetrack. And then we're going to participate in communion together. So as the kids and parents are heading back up, if you just join me in prayer. Lord, we just come before you. We thank you for this message of the gospel, that it is truly good news. Let it penetrate our hearts and overjoy us so much that we cannot help but share your good news to other people. Let the good news transform us. Let us be renewed by this good news. And let us follow you as sent people to wherever you will go. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.